November 7th, 1941, a date which will live in infamy.
Bob, why are men so crazy about sweater girls?
I don't know, Judy. That's one mystery I'd like to unravel.
America, 1944. Our world had changed. The needs of war had radically altered the social fabric of the nation. We battled on many fronts. At home, we fought for a new vision of what America could be. And that struggle changed our lives.
With my high starched collar and my high top shoes and my hair piled high upon my head,
she went to find a jolly hour on the trolley and found my heart instead.
With his light brown derby and his bright green tie, he was quite the handsomest of men.
I started to yen, so I counted to ten, then I counted to ten again. Clang, clang, clang went the trolley. Ding, ding, ding went the bell.
Zing, zing, zing went my heartstrings. For the moment I saw him, I fell. Chug, chug, chug went the motor.
Bump, bump, bump went the brain. Thump, thump, thump went my heartstrings. When she smiled, I could feel the car shake.
In Europe, the tide was beginning to turn. The Allies landed in Italy near the seaport of Anzio under heavy counterattack by German forces along the coast. The area was finally secured. Allied forces had made a major breakthrough. Only one road would, after all, lead to Rome. In the Pacific, too, our luck had been changing. Our troops were persistently moving toward Japan, taking one island after another. Early in 1944, we took the Marshall Islands. General Douglas MacArthur, in bold moves devastating to the Japanese, swept his troops onward, determined to return to the Philippines. To soldiers, the islands offered little more than rest and the hope of a letter from home.
Mama's mail's coming through pretty good, but as a sweet little Georgia peach, I sure would love to hear from.
Hey, Frankie. What about your mail? You get any?
With a puss like mine, who's gonna write to me but me mother?
Wherever they fought, our GIs faced unfamiliar terrain, harsh conditions, and the daily threat of death. But perhaps most difficult of all, was the separation from loved ones.
Do nothing till you hear from me. Pay no attention to what's said. Why people tear the seam of anyone's dream is over my head. Do nothing till you hear from me. At least consider our romance. If you should take the word of others you've heard, I haven't a chance. True, I've been seen with someone new, but does that mean that I'm untrue when we're apart? Words in my heart reveal how I feel about you. Some kiss may cloud my memory. And other arms may hold a thrill. But please do nothing till you hear it from me. And you never will.
They miss their girls. They miss their families. But above all, they missed a good home-cooked meal. Bob Hope recruited Lana Turner, and together they fulfilled a GI's dream.
Well, gang, Command Performance has filled many an order for those sounds that remind you of home, from the bleat of a billy goat to the fizz of a bourbon and soda. And now comes the Ordnance Gang at 863 with a letter from Sarge Everett Hinkey and Corporal Roland Lipton and this little dilly. Please have Lana Turner come out and fry us a 3-inch porterhouse steak smothered with onions, and let's hear it sizzle. Just to prove there's no request too large, fellas, here she is, Lana Turner.
Hello, fellas. And hi, Bob. Say, have the FBI men found a steak yet?
Yes, it's backstage. But, Lana, this is dangerous. If this audience sees steak, they'll come right up here after it.
Oh, I don't know. They've seen ham all evening, and you're still here. Bring on the porterhouse steak!
Well, look, they got an armed guard around the steak.
Look at this.
Well, all right, Bob. Is your griddle hot?
Yeah, I think so. That'll
do, Bob. Now, the steak, please. Oh, well, here it is, fellas. Beautiful. A porterhouse steak 3 inches thick. The only one in captivity.
You gonna give that a hot foot?
Into the frying pan.
Oh, no.
Oh, yes. There you are, fellas. That's the sound of a steak sizzling.
Fellas, that's the steak. That's not me sizzling. That's the steak.
And fellas, I wish I could cook a big steak for each and every one of you.
If the GIs suffered the hardships of war, the home front was also struck by disaster. On July 6, 1944, a fire swept through the circus that had come to Hartford, Connecticut. The 19-ton big top had crashed down on the crowd, killing 169 people. More than half were children. A year later, the Empire State Building, hidden by fog, was hit by a Mitchell bomber headed for nearby Newark Airport. The story was related in newsreels.
13 died, including the crew members, two Army men and a Navy hitchhiker. When the plane hit the north side of the building, parts of it jammed in the structure and some plummeted down the elevator shaft, while other parts of the B-25 passed through the building. So great was the impact. Disaster units organized in wartime were quick to respond to aid the wounded.
Here's Dick Tracy. Let's see what Dick Tracy is doing.
You remember?
When newspaper deliverers went on strike in New York City on June 30th, 1945, Mayor Fiorello LaGuardia took to the airwaves. It was the comics he brought to New Yorkers over the radio.
3,000, 4,000. Now he's getting into the hundreds. 600, 700, 800. And the picture shows a hand of breathless stretching out. She's got hold of that iron pot. Remember the iron pot she took from the Van Hoosen's gardener's flat to put the money in? And crash! She crashes it on his head.
Okay. Then maybe you'd like some more of your laundry torn to pieces. Rip! She's ripping the laundry there, and that little delicate piece of lingerie. And say, children, what does it all mean? It means that dirty money never brings any luck.
We devoured newspapers for both the comic strips and for news of our boys. War correspondent Ernie Pyle's book, Brave Men, was one of 1944's bestsellers, along with John Hersey's A Bell for a Donno, Somerset Maugham's Razor's Edge, Lillian Smith's Strange Fruit, and Kathleen Windsor's sizzling Forever Amber. Paper shortages brought the proliferation of paperback books, handy also for GI pockets. Periodicals reduced circulation and urged people to share their magazines. Congress passed the GI Bill of Rights, providing funds for education, loans, VA hospitals, and other benefits for veterans. As an indirect result of the war, returning veterans were given the opportunity to advance themselves. FDR signed the bill on June 22, 1944. The big studios of Hollywood participated in drives for war bonds. Here a young girl tries to get a berth on the Crosby Hope Victory Bond Tour train, her only chance of getting a train ride to Washington to see her wounded brother.
King's over at the recording stage watching Carmen Cavallero rehearse a number. Now you go on over there and tell him I said to get you on that train. Go on.
Oh, thank you, Miss Stanwyck. Thank you. Goodbye.
Bye.
So I just got to see Mr. Crosby, please.
Sure, sure. Look, lady, nobody gets in here without a pass. Not even... Oh, hiya, Mr. Bensley. Got a pass for the lady?
She doesn't need one, Bill. She's my new stand-in.
Oh, well, that's okay, then. What do you mean, stand-in? That girl's a woman. She... Hey! Hey! Come back here!
Why, Bella, don't you know it isn't nice to chase little girls?
She hasn't got a pass.
Mr. Land, he's trying to keep me from seeing Bing Crosby.
Hey, what are you, Bob Hope's secret agent?
She hasn't got a pass.
Oh, I've just got to see Mr. Crosby. The Victory Caravan's leaving tonight, and I just have to be on it.
You do? Well, you go ahead. I'll take care of Willie.
Oh, thanks.
Oh, no, you don't.
Hey, this is more fun in real life than it is in the movies.
You know, Bing, it's for boys like him that we're doing this Victory Caravan.
Well, it's certainly little enough to do. Look at the fruit salad on his chest there, huh? Looks like your big brother's been up where they really play for keeps.
And all they ask us to do is to buy victory bonds.
Honey, we're going to get you on that train if we have to make the engineer get off and walk.
Oh, I know it's a lot to ask you, Mr. Hope, but my brother's so lonesome.
Look, there's nothing I wouldn't do for a GI, but lard and myself in a lower berth?
Speak to me. Say something. Come on, Gluefoot. Giddy up there. Giddy up, Gluefoot. Come on. Come on, boy. Get in the money. Just once.
War bonds helped finance the $2 billion top secret Manhattan Project. Most workers involved in the project did not even know they were helping to build the world's first atom bomb.
At Oak Ridge, Tennessee, are two of the giant plants where the atomic bomb is produced. A 59,000-acre military area, a city where 75,000 people worked in absolute secrecy on history's most sensational secret.
The actual construction of the bomb was directed by University of California physicist J. Robert Oppenheimer at an isolated site on a high mesa in Los Alamos, New Mexico. More than 25 universities and 37 industrial concerns were called upon to aid in the creation of the bomb, though the actual objective of the Manhattan Project was known to only a dozen or so people. In June 1944, the Allies entered Rome. The Eternal City was liberated, and the German occupiers soon surrendered Italy. The GIs in the field produce their own entertainment and a few stars to enjoy their show.
Added to our program by Hollywood's lovely Marlena Dietrich. Miss Dietrich, who has just recovered from a siege of pneumonia contracted here on the Italian front, has graciously joined us here to pay her respects to the Fifth Army. Here she is, lovely Miss Dietrich.
Hello, boys. I want to say that sharing this entertainment with you today is to me more important than doing the entertaining. I had hardly thought it possible that entertainment of such high caliber could be presented out here in the field. I wish to add my respect and admiration along with General Clark and Irving Berlin to the men and women of the Fifth Army. If morale is kept as high, such as I've seen during my visit here in Italy, I'm certain that we can look forward to a speedy victory. Goodbye, good luck, Godspeed.
A major turning point in the Pacific was the victory over Saipan in the Marianas that same summer. 800 Allied ships with 162,000 men converged around Saipan. The Japanese fleet was ready. It took the U.S. 3.5 weeks to conquer the island in one of the bloodiest air and naval battles of the Pacific. Casualties were heavy on both sides, but devastating for the Japanese, who lost more than 10,000 soldiers.
Sitting in the midst of Beverly Hills, the one and only Jack Benny. Listen in.
Here's one from Fred Allen. He says, I can't stand Jack Benny because he can't stand me more than I can stand him.
To relieve the tension of the war, zaniness and nonsense tunes caught on.
Roosevelt.
1944 was an election year, and the Democratic National Convention nominated Roosevelt for a fourth term. As usual, his strategy was to be too busy to campaign. His opponent, Thomas E. Dewey, hardly stood a chance. The Republican campaign stressed FDR's failing health and his age. Dewey was 42, Roosevelt 62. Roosevelt and his running mate, Senator Harry S. Truman, faced a campaign that sometimes resorted to trivial accusations, but FDR was quick to respond.
These Republican leaders have not been content with attacks on me, or on my wife, or on my sons. No, not content with that. They now include my little dog, Fowler. Well, of course, I don't resent attacks. And my family don't resent attacks. But Fowler does resent attacks.
The U.S. had been pouring heavy equipment and armaments over to England in preparation for an invasion across the English Channel. Stockpiled even in neighborhoods and empty warehouses, the Great Armada was assembled over a period of many months. Thousands of ships, planes, tanks, and jeeps were readied as nearly 3 million men prepared for the audacious plan to invade German-occupied territory. The Allies planned to hit Normandy. If the Germans could be caught off guard, D-Day would see the Allies establish a firm beachhead in France. The Germans controlled the Atlantic coast from Denmark to Spain, but instead of concentrating their attention on Eisenhower, they kept tabs on Patton's movements in England, little more than a diversion from the real invasion at Normandy. General Eisenhower knew the daring of his plan.
Soldiers, sailors, and airmen of the Allied Expeditionary Force, you are about to embark upon the Great Crusade, toward which we have striven these many months. The eyes of the world are upon you. Your task will not be an easy one. Your enemy is well trained, well equipped, and battle hardened. He will fight savagely. But this is the year 1944. The United Nations have inflicted upon the Germans great defeats. Our air offensive has seriously reduced their strength in the air and their capacity to wage war on the ground. The tide has turned. I have full confidence in your courage, devotion to duty, and skill in battle. We will accept nothing less than full victory.
Allied naval forces, supported by strong air forces, began landing Allied armies this morning on the northern coast of France.
In his column, Ernie Pyle wrote, "The only way to take a beach is to face it and keep going. It is costly at first, but it's the only way." And that's how we did it. We had surprise on our side. On their side, the Germans had heavy artillery. For a while, the outcome was in doubt. But through sheer courage, we cleared a path through occupied territory. The liberation of France had begun. In army camps, movies took soldiers' minds off the coming arduous months at the front. In movie theaters across the nation, we all went through a similar lineup. A travelogue followed by a newsreel, previews of coming attractions, and then finally, the feature film. Whether burlesque, or drama, romance, or the war, we swallowed the medicine Hollywood served and were reminded to help our favorite charity or the war effort at the same time. Even Fibber McGee and Molly went to the movies.
Special rates for service men, sir?
What war, sir?
World War I. The big war.
Sorry, full price, please. 25 years you've been trying to get away with that, dearie, and it hasn't worked yet.
Though travelogues often used fake settings, they made us even more aware of foreign locales.
Two girls on a beach with a seashell. It must have said something nice, judging by that smile. Now the camera rolls back on a dolly, which is not something with a hole in its stocking. You see, the beach is handmade, the grass is prop, but believe me, the seashell is real. The girls use it to practice different camera angles.
The underground forces of liberation knew their finest hour when the people of Paris rose to strike at the enemy. Even as the Allies battered at the gates, freedom returned to the city of life.
I wish that guy with the sacks would give up. Gets on my nerves.
Forget it. Have a drink.
Aren't you afraid I might take you up on it?
Some movies reflected a certain cynicism on the home front. Cynicism, a lack of direction, and a sense of despair in a society where some 11% of the population was away at war.
Thanks.
Plenty of people die in this minute. I would give anything to trade places with you.
I know what I'm talking about.
I'm not so sure. At least they know they're done for. They don't have to sweat blood wondering if they are.
Your philosophy stinks, pal. We all know we're going to kick off someday. It's only a question of when.
But what got us on this subject anyway? We'll be discussing politics next.
Yeah.
But I can't go back to school and face everybody, as long as Joe's in burlesque.
Gee, wouldn't it be wonderful if Arthur Hale fell in love with Joe and put her in his new show?
Wait, I've got it.
Well, what is it?
I can sing that music. I'll get Mr. Hale to put me in his show. You,
Other movies created bubbly fantasies around the fighting men who were our heroes.
Gosh, what a heroic thought.
Yes, isn't it? There's only one thing wrong. Mr. Hale might think I'm too young.
Well, all you gotta do then is make him think you're older.
Hiya, Sherry.
Hello, Sailor. How's about dropping anchor for a minute?
What do you mean, a minute? I've got 30 days to do nothing but talk to beautiful women.
Hello, Mr. Hale.
Hello there.
Hello.
Hello.
Need any help, Sailor? Always glad to help the Navy.
Listen, Leatherneck, this beachhead's taken. Go jingle your medal somewhere else.
Medal?
We watch the previews of coming attractions, films that use timeless sentiments to bridge the gap between fantasy and the real world.
Me into your life.
But you're married, Ellen.
We're both old enough to vote.
This is Jim Cagney. I hope you'll understand it if I break down and sing a song together with two other sentimentalists, Keenan Wynn and Groucho Marx.
The electorate proved how much it had invested in one man. We reelected Franklin Delano Roosevelt to a fourth term. In 1944, for the first time, a city other than Chicago or New York saw two teams from the same town vying in the World Series. The city was St. Louis, and the two teams were the Cardinals and the Browns. Ultimately, the Cardinals won the series 4-2. In football, the game of the year was Army versus Navy. It was a memorable match featuring West Point's highly touted touchdown twins, number 35, Felix Doc Blanchard, and number 41, Glenn Davis. Davis and Blanchard led Army to a 23-7 victory, giving the cadets their first unbeaten, untied season in 28 years. Thousands of miles away in the Pacific, the Japanese came up with perhaps the most incredible weapon, the kamikaze. In Japanese, kamikaze means divine wind, and these suicide pilots soared with a selfless devotion to their cause. Laden with explosives, they crash-dived into ships and other targets, ensuring the success of their missions with their lives. It was Christmas, 1944. Brothers and sons, husbands and fathers were too far away to spend it with us. But at least we tried to send them our best wishes in loving ways.
Who are all these children, Eleanor?
These are my four sisters, and our brother Fred is a gunner's mate.
How would you all like to say hello to Fred?
Merry Christmas, Fred.
Merry Christmas, Johnny.
Merry Christmas, Louie.
Thank you, Louie.
By the end of 1944, Eisenhower's troops had reached Nazi Germany. Patton's Third Army had been called in to hold back a German counterattack in Belgium and Luxembourg along an 85-mile bulge in the front line. U.S. troops finally smothered the last Nazi offensive in the Battle of the Bulge, and by the spring, the Allies would be pouring across the Siegfried Line into Germany.
In the days and the years that are come, we shall work for a just and honorable peace, a durable peace, as today we work and fight for a total victory in war. We can and we will achieve such a peace.
The following month, Roosevelt met with Stalin and Churchill in the Soviet city of Yalta to chart the occupation of Germany. They also divided up Eastern Europe and the Balkans, seemingly ignoring the principles of self-determination asserted in the Atlantic Charter. The United States and the Soviet Union emerged from Yalta as superpowers. Upon his return home, FDR made his last major public address to the nation.
The defeat of Germany will not mean the end of the war against Japan. On the contrary, we must be prepared for a long and costly struggle in the Pacific. But the unconditional surrender of Japan is as essential as the defeat of Germany.
By 1945, the Allies were closing in on Japan. Leapfrogging from island to island, the U.S. had taken key Japanese strongholds. The next step was the Philippines, and MacArthur made good his promise to return.
When I landed on your soil, I said to the people of the Philippines whence I came, I shall return.
Iwo Jima, a volcanic island halfway between Guam and Tokyo, was a vital defense station for the Japanese. Radar stations on the island immediately informed Tokyo, 760 miles to the north, of any attempt at a surprise attack. The Americans had to capture the island. February 19, 1945, the U.S. Marines swept onto the 8-mile square barren island. The blackened land, charred by volcanic ash, hailed the invaders with a deathly face of woe and desolation. It took several days to reach the surrounding hills, where Japanese forces had been raining hellfire on the attacking U.S. troops. Some 5,000 Americans died, claiming that arid island of soot. And when the American flag was raised on Mount Suribachi, Marines wept unashamed.
Another project that provided a shortcut to war problems turns to peacetime service. The electromechanical differential analyzer performs scientific and industrial marvels at the Massachusetts Institute of Technology.
The war was helping to foster inventions that would have far-reaching effects, such as the first computer.
Beyond the ordinary methods of calculation. 2,000 electronic tubes, several thousand relays, 150 motors, and about 200 miles of wire are contained in this intricate apparatus. The analyzer worked for 3 years on important war projects, including range tables for our Navy's mighty guns. A mechanical marvel.
We welcomed modern technology, but cherished our national traditions.
In the final judging, Miss New York City, Bess Meyerson, is the center of all lenses, as she's awarded the crown of Miss America 1945. The new queen, who eliminated 40 beauties, says she has turned down all personal appearance tours and movie contracts. She intends to use a $5,000 scholarship prize to continue her musical studies.
In April 1945, Soviet forces converged on Berlin. The planes of the Red Army showered bombs on the city, and the sound of tanks reverberated throughout the streets.
Captured German films show the havoc wrought by concentrated air attack. Herr Goebbels said positively it couldn't happen. Is smoke getting in your eyes, Herr Goebbels? Weary Berliners reenact scenes reminiscent of the London Blitz. victims of their faith in the Luftwaffe. 50,000 tons of bombs are the price of belief in Hitler, whose capital is dissolving with his regime.
On April 25th, 75 miles south of Berlin at Torgau on the Elbe River, American and Soviet soldiers linked up with each other. From opposite directions, the two great armies had squeezed the German troops into surrender. Mutually recognizing their strength and greatness, the soldiers and officers shed all decorum. In a heady moment of joy and relief, they embraced, drinking and dancing the night away in wild celebration. It was a symbolic and historic instant, perhaps never to be repeated. A week earlier, on April 18th, Ernie Pyle, adored by hundreds of thousands of Americans for bringing the reality of the GI's war home to them, was killed on an island in the Pacific. On his body was found a draft he was preparing for his column. He had written, "Dead men by mass production. Dead men in such familiar promiscuity that they become monotonous. Dead men in such monstrous infinity that you almost come to hate them. These are the things that you at home need not even try to understand. You didn't see them lying so grotesque beside the gravel road. We saw them. We saw them by the multiple thousands. That's the difference." On April 12, 1945, stunning news spread across the United States. President Franklin Delano Roosevelt was dead. The president had succumbed to a massive cerebral hemorrhage at his residence in Warm Springs, Georgia. FDR's body was brought back to Washington by train. Along the route, people gathered to bid their last farewell to the man who had taken them through 12 years of tragedy and triumph, the man who had led America from despair to self-confidence. For many Americans, he would remain our greatest hero, the president who rallied to the cause of the common man. And now America had a new president.
My duties and responsibilities are clear. I have assumed them. I know the strain, the mud, the misery, the utter weariness of the soldier in the field. And I know, too, his courage, his stamina, and his faith in his comrades, his country, and himself.
On April 26th, Italian partisans captured Benito Mussolini. He and his mistress, Clara Petacci, were shot. Their bodies were strung up in a public square in Milan, where the liberated Italians could finally unleash their vengeance on the fallen dictator. Someone saw fit to fasten Petacci's skirt to her legs. She would be spared her modesty, but not the venom of the crowd. Devastated by Allied forces, Germany was in shambles. Hitler had retreated to a bunker beneath the Berlin chancel. Suffering from delusions, he shouted orders to armies that no longer existed, commanded generals who no longer listened, spoke to a nation that no longer heard. On April 30th, Hitler and his new bride, Eva Braun, committed suicide. Their bodies were immediately cremated, and the century's most evil and distorted mind turned to ashes. On May 7th, 1945, Germany surrendered to the Allies. The war in Europe was over at last. The long-awaited day had finally arrived, and Americans at home could now be more hopeful of a victory in the Pacific, too. On May 8th, delirious crowds celebrated VE Day. But it was not until the concentration camps were liberated that Americans at home realized the scope of the Nazi horror. 6 million Jews were exterminated. 1 million Soviet prisoners of war and 2 million others, including Catholics, communists, social democrats, gypsies, French resistance fighters, homosexuals, and the mentally ill, died in the camps. Mankind itself was scarred. In America, we were experimenting with a horror of our own making. On July 16th, in a remote part of the New Mexico desert named Jornada del Muerto, Journey of the Dead, the atomic bomb was secretly tested. The tremors were felt 235 miles away. The Army explained that an ammunition dump had exploded. Oppenheimer himself stressed that in peacetime, atomic energy should be used to improve people's lives. Later, he would become a prime proponent of joint U.S.-Soviet control of atomic weapons, warning of the deadly dangers of a nuclear armaments race. But in 1945, the average American was years away from thinking about hypothetical nuclear disasters.
Sure, I'm for it, John, but I loaded up with war bonds.
The government still encouraged us to buy bonds in a time when victory seemed imminent but was not yet certain.
I always went over the quarter, but this time I just can't afford it. I'm sorry, I can't afford it.
Hold on, Joe. There's something I want to say to you.
Are you talking to me?
Yeah, and I'm going to give it to you quick. You know, we've got a lot of boys and girls fighting this war for us, and they're doing a great job. Maybe too great, because you're beginning to feel good again. You think peace is just around the corner, so now you're going to go in there and buy yourself a nice new suit of clothes. Been a good guy up to now. Yeah, but you're quitting. Quitting, Joe, before the job is over. That's what you can't afford.
I never looked at it like that before.
Well, maybe some other folks haven't either. But if we want to look those boys and girls in the eye when they come marching home, or if we want to look ourselves in the eye, we won't quit. Now, the fourth wall loan drive is on, and nobody can afford to buy that extra suit or that extra dress or those unrationed shoes.
Bess Truman was trying to christen an airplane, but the champagne bottle proved to be too strong a match for the First Lady. At least Mrs. Truman wasn't alone in her predicament. In July 1945, President Truman went to the Potsdam Conference for a meeting with Churchill and Stalin that was to determine history for decades to come.
The president takes time out to enjoy some of that good Navy chow with the seamen. The man on whose shoulders rest the crushing responsibilities of the coming conference and the winning of a war against Japan takes time to eat and chat with American sailors. Mr. Truman debarked at Antwerp, Belgium, and was flown to his momentous conference near Berlin, where he met Prime Minister Churchill and Marshal Stalin.
Germany was demilitarized and the Nazi Party abolished. Other territorial claims, notably in Eastern Europe and in the Balkans, were mapped out at Potsdam, and the terms set for the unconditional surrender of Japan. The way was paved for victory in the Pacific. While the nation waited restlessly for an outcome to the Japanese war, we prepared for the next leap in the brutal Pacific War with heavy hearts. At home, we held our breath with anticipation, but the really important leaps would be up to our top leaders. In the meantime, soldiers hoping for a speedy end to fighting once again began to turn their thoughts to families and marriage. One wedding caught the public eye when child star Shirley Temple, 17 years old, married Sergeant John Agar. One-armed outfielder Pete Gray of the St. Louis Browns got his chance at the big leagues with so many stars away at war. Gray amazed baseball fans with his steady fielding and his 51 solid base hits. Baseball stadiums once again filled to capacity. Hank Greenberg was one of many baseball greats who returned from World War II in time for the close of the 1945 season. But no one else had the immediate impact of Hammerin' Hank. In the World Series, Hank showed everyone it was business as usual. He banged out 7 big hits, including 3 doubles and 2 home runs, leading the Detroit Tigers to victory over the Chicago Cubs. But the war was not over yet.
There can be no peace in the world until the military power of Japan is destroyed. To do that, we are now engaged in a process of deploying millions of our armed forces against Japan in a mass movement of troops and supplies and weapons over 14,000 miles, a military and naval feat unequaled in all history. If the Japanese insist on continuing resistance beyond the point of reason, their country will suffer the same destruction as Germany. Our blows will destroy their whole modern industrial plant and organization, which they have built up during the past century, and which they are now devoting to a hopeless cause.
A drastic way to end the war was chosen. On August 6th, Colonel Paul Tibbets took off in his B-29, the Enola Gay, named after his mother. On board was the first nuclear weapon, the atom bomb. The target, Hiroshima, to be followed 3 days later by Nagasaki. The devastation was beyond anyone's nightmares. For 3/4 of a mile, all around the center of the explosion, nothing remained. Tens of thousands of people were instantly killed. Thousands more died slowly in agony.
I have received this afternoon a message from the Japanese government in reply to the message forwarded to that government by the Secretary of State on August 11th. I deem this reply a full acceptance of the Potsdam Declaration, which specifies the unconditional surrender of Japan. In the reply, there is no qualification.
Newsmen rush the President's report to a waiting world. In New York City, as throughout a rejoicing nation and world, vast throngs of grateful, happy people celebrate the end of fighting, the dawn of peace. 2 million New Yorkers jam Times Square. It's official. It's all over. It's total victory.
We welcomed home the men who had won the war. General Patton received a hero's welcome in Los Angeles. His decisive style in North Africa and Sicily earned him a reputation as one of the war's outstanding commanders. General Jonathan Wainwright, emaciated after 3 years in a Japanese prisoner of war camp, was cheered by his countrymen on September 10, 1945. He arrived in Washington, where President Truman presented him with the Congressional Medal of Honor. But our greatest hero was probably General Dwight D. Eisenhower. Crowds came out to greet him when he arrived in New York, and he responded by humoring them.
As my first act as a citizen of the city of New York, I want to issue to the mayor a word of warning. New York simply can't do this to a Kansas farmer boy and keep its reputation for sophistication.
In 1945, in San Francisco, the charter of the newly formed United Nations was signed. Leaders from all over the world hoped for better communication among peoples of diverse cultural, racial, and economic backgrounds. The stage was set for a new era of internationalism, and America was now in the forefront of the world's political scene. The boys were finally coming home, all except 400,000. They were coming home to a more prosperous America than they had left, and for their wives and mothers, the long days of loneliness and fear were over. For American women, the homecoming had another significance. They too would be going home. Most would give their welder's overalls back to their husbands and sons. G.I. Joe was back, and Rosie the Riveter once again became Harriet the housewife.
Oh, I don't mind my wife working, but who's going to run my home?
My wife works, people think I can't support her.
Though they had taken a liking to their new independence and economic freedom, even to the factory jobs themselves, many women reluctantly, though obediently, went home when they were forced to turn their jobs over to the men. But they would forever remain marked by their experience. Home would never be quite the doll's house it had once been. And if they couldn't be independent, then perhaps their daughters would. The post-World War II woman had gained a new self-confidence, but her status in the modern working world remained inferior.
The Supreme Commander for the Allied Powers will now sign on behalf of all the nations at war with Japan.
Fleet Admiral Chester Nimitz followed General MacArthur in signing the Japanese surrender document aboard the battleship Missouri on September 2nd. Peace was in the minds of all present. Peace and the hope for a better world, a world based on mutual faith, understanding, and tolerance. Japan's foreign minister, Mamoru Shigemitsu, limping on his wooden leg, signed for his country. He was followed by Chief of the Imperial General Staff, General Yoshijiro Umezu. MacArthur pronounced the final words.
These proceedings are closed.
In America, a new chapter of history was beginning. It was a chapter that would be characterized by luxury and prosperity, by the rise of the suburbs, by the expansion of the economy, by the baby boom.
Coca. So sing and make a rhyme, guarantee you one good real fine time.
Drinking rum and Coca-Cola, drinking rum and Coca-Cola.
Drinking rum and Coca-Cola, go down Point Cunama. Both mother and daughter, working for the Yankee dollar. Drinking rum,
drinking rum and Coca-Cola.
Drinking
rum and Coca-Cola.
We had a vision of a new and more prosperous life, and we wanted to make it ours. The next few years would reveal how we would cope with the atomic age, in the brave new world we were creating.
Like Trinidad coastline, one thing that you see so plain, she's a little plump around Port of Spain.
Pink and round
with Coca-Cola.
We'll be right back.